Ever see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Oops, great. Hello, hello everybody. Very nice to see you all. Would have been nicer to see you in person, but we have to do this online, and that's fine. Thanks a lot, first of all, to everybody for being here, and also to the organizing committee of this workshop. For inviting me to speak and to share some of the work we did together in the past few years around this cherished project. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to discuss a bit how we did seismic risk assessment within the cherished project from a more quantitative perspective. So I will share some of the results of our work in Iloilo during the project. So, has already been said, so I'm based in London in the UK. It's 6 in the morning here, and so I work in the area of civil and structural engineering, with special focus on earthquake engineering. So today in this talk, I have about 40 minutes, so I'll try to be on time. I'm going again to briefly talk about our cherished project. I'm sure our previous speakers have already well informed you all about our project, but a few details on the various work packages and the way we structure the project and also its aim and objectives. Then I'm going to give a bit of background on how we do quantitative risk assessment, some basic concept, particularly around this concept of fragility analysis, and I'll clarify what that means in a few minutes. And then, so before working on this cherished project, I was delighted to work together with Professor Reta and Professor Gasciano and their team at De La Salle University on another project, which is called SCOSSO, which had some sort of similar aims and objectives, but was focused on school buildings rather than heritage structures. And so this really the same methodology that we developed within the SCOSSO project has inspired also the methodology that we have applied in this cherished project. So I'll show some of the work we did for SCOSSO and how this has led to the cherished methodology. And then, as I said, I'll present some results of the risk assessment and risk prioritization within the cherished project applied to Iloilo City. So let's start again with brief introduction to the project. Again, at this you have been at this workshop for the past few hours, so you know by now why we are particularly interested in looking at risk and multi-hazard risk of heritage structures. Particularly 190 UNESCO sites all over the world are in areas that are very prone to natural hazards, and particular 80% of those UNESCO sites are in areas that are exposed to ground shaking from earthquake, extreme wind, flooding, impact of climate change, and so on. So it's particularly important that we try to assess, to understand the risk and to assess in a quantitative way the risk that those assets are exposed to, and so that we can then try to plan some mitigation action and some disaster risk reduction action that could help in reducing these risks. So now you are all based in the Philippines, so I don't and you have gone with Dr. Gigi again through this earlier this morning, so I don't think I need to spend much time on this. But you know that unfortunately Philippines is affected by several type of natural hazards. Here there are like some statistics of, you know, you have at least 5 earthquakes per day. Of any, of course, many of them are not very strong, and so we don't even feel them, but still there are some moderate to large earthquakes that happen very frequently. And you may all remember well the 7.2 magnitude in Bohol in 2013, and I'll go back to that in a few minutes. There are volcanoes, there are at least 20 typhoons per year, especially from July to November, and again, you may all well remember the typhoon Yolanda in 2013, so in the same year of the Bohol earthquake that has been especially damaging, particularly for heritage structures, as I'll show in a second. precipitations and then flood as a consequence of that, pluvial floods, again very frequent, and then also there are some landslides that can be induced by either rain or in some cases by ground shaking. And here again, it's some just from in the last century, some of the bit more than last century, some of the statistics of actual numbers of these very damaging events that have affected the country. So now, as I said, heritage structures are exposed to those type of hazards, but we also know that heritage is important for the economy, not just in the Philippines, all over the world. I'm actually originally from Italy. I'm based in London, but I'm Italian, and in Italy that's it's exactly the same. So we rely a lot on culture tourism, and of course that's an important aspect of our economy due to the potential for job and also the revenues that come from culture tourism. We also know, I think, that the one of the questions a few minutes ago was around the intangible value of heritage. And again, we know that cultural heritage is particularly important for communities as a sense of feeling of a place and also the identity of community. So this is why even more we need to make sure that we can assess the risk of heritage assets and try to reduce it. And then, as I said before, some recent events, particularly in the Philippines, so the Bohol earthquake and the Yolanda typhoon in 2013, they have clearly showed that cultural heritage in the Philippines are particularly vulnerable to natural hazards due to the fact that there are centuries old buildings, but also due to the type of construction that in some cases doesn't follow any building code or any standard. So it's and then make those structure especially vulnerable. And again, this is specifically for the Philippines, but it's pretty much in many other countries you have exactly the same points. And again, Italy is a very good example where you can see exactly those same points that I'm reporting here. So yeah, the two main ones were the Bohol earthquake. So in particular, the damage to churches was estimated at over $30 million. And this really doesn't quantify the social impact of the damage and collapse of some of those structures. And similarly for the Typhoon Yolanda in the same year. So based on those, we decided to develop this Cherish project. So the overall aim was to, so we know that heritage structures are especially vulnerable to natural hazards. So we want to try to understand how we can quantify the risk, but also the resilience of those assets. And so we were looking at some specific objectives. We've been looking at some specific objectives over the past couple of years working on this project. So first of all, we want to understand how we could use, for instance, innovative tools, like for instance, drones. In collaboration with the Cherish investigator, for instance, we were able to survey by using drones, by using 3D cameras and new technology, all the buildings there in Iloilo. So we also wanted to kind of review and understand and harmonize all the guidelines that already exist. So we didn't want to reinvent the wheel. We want to use existing tools, existing guidelines, and see how we could customize those tools and those guidelines, particularly for our case studies in Iloilo. And again, Professor Andy has already shown some of those tools and has already guided you through some of those tools. And I will add something more from what we've been doing together on that. Then, as Rodella has shown you as well, one important aim of the project was also to promote the community awareness of the vulnerability, but also the importance of heritage not just in Iloilo, but really across the Philippines and even more globally. So that's an important one. And then We have been doing a sort of technology transfer workshop. This one is a good example of what we are doing right now. So the idea was also to, not just do research on our own, but also try to organize workshops, seminars in the UK, but also in the Philippines and also in other countries where we could show some of our results and really make sure that there was a transfer of what we have learned in the field to other places. So the project was organizing three main work packages, three main activities. The first one was more the engineering side, and it's what I'm going to talk about today. So we were looking at how we could assess the physical vulnerability of structure, and together with Professor Reta, with Richard, with Mary, so we were working particularly on this task. Then there was more the social and cultural vulnerability, and this is what again Rodella has been discussing earlier this morning, and where she's been leading this work. And then altogether, we were also looking how we could develop some sort of solutions to try to reduce the risk and improve the resilience of those assets. And so something that was very interesting was that really this project was very multidisciplinary in the sense that it was, starting from engineering. That is my background, but we were also working with people in social science and more in general in art and humanities. And really, we were trying not just to work disciplines in parallel, but also then bringing disciplines together in trying to find solutions on how to improve the resilience of those assets. And we worked together across the UK and the Philippines, together also with external partners. For instance, from the University of Naples in Italy that supported us in the field work, and also some industrial partners here in the UK that have helped us in developing some of those tools. So that's a quick overview, maybe not too quick, but I think it's a useful overview again of where we are. What I'm going to cover now more in detail is this first part around, and again, you have already learned a lot in the past few hours thanks to my colleagues. So I'm hopefully adding just a bit more on this aspect of engineering, on those engineering aspects for heritage. So I'm quickly introducing again, you have seen this already, but I'm going quickly again through the concept of risk assessment, and particularly I'm introducing this concept that maybe you have not seen much until now, but that's important because we'll use it later on of fragility analysis. So you have seen already today that when we talk about risk, we need to have various. Oh, sorry, we need to have various components. The first one is what we call the hazard that Dr. Gigi has guided you through. So where essentially we are interested in understanding for a given type of hazard, that could be earthquake, could be flood, could be typhoon, what is the probability of having some level of intensity that are going to impact our built environment, so our structures, people, infrastructure, and so on. So this first component really tells us what are possible scenarios that can affect our case study area, and also how we can quantify those events in terms of some intensity that can be, for instance, the ground shaking, if you are looking at seismic, as you have seen earlier with Dr. Gigi. So in terms of the ground acceleration, of spectral acceleration, and so on. Could be wind speed if you are looking at typhoon, could be water depth if you are looking at flood, and so on. So once you have this information, then we can go in the next step, which is the vulnerability one. So the vulnerability tells us, given the intensity, what is the level of damage that we expect for our structures. And of course, if we look at a real city, a real case study area, of course we'll have thousands and thousands and thousands of structures. So what we try to do is to always have what we call an exposure database. So an exposure database, what does classifies all the type of buildings in a given area in some sort of typologies, in some sort of construction classes, for which we can then develop these vulnerability models. And then the idea is that once we have the level of damage, so we have the intensity of our event, for instance, our ground shaking, we know what is the level of damage for that level of intensity or for a set or for a range of intensities, we can then estimate the damage for various exposure. And then what we want to do is also to convert this damage in what we call losses. So in terms of some sort, for instance, of economic losses, for instance, dollar losses. Why that? Because of course, so if you are a structure engineer, you may be able to, understand and describe damage in terms of engineering metrics. For instance, I can say for a magnitude 7 earthquake at 10 kilometers from my heritage asset, I will have, a displacement of the roof of 1 meter, I will have some cracking, I can describe the damage in terms of engineering metrics. But if you are a stakeholder, you may not necessarily be familiar with those very, engineering specific metrics. And so what we want to do is to try to convert always damage in terms of economic losses. So it's much easier to understand to say, for instance, for an earthquake of magnitude 7 and 10 kilometers from my asset, I will have a loss of, 1 million. It's something that everybody can understand and so can make decision based on that value in dollar value, and not again just using purely engineering and structure engineering type of metrics. Of course, when we work with heritage, this becomes very complicated, as you said before, because of course it's not just the physical damage, and so it's not just the how much it costs to repair that structure. So it's not just the dollar losses, but it's also all the intangible value that our heritage assets have and that we want to try to quantify. And I'll discuss a bit later how we try to do that in a similar way to what Professor Orreta has already explained. So particularly I'm focusing a bit more on this vulnerability one, again, as a structure engineer myself, but so as I said before, exposure is how we classify buildings by their main characteristics, while vulnerability is really tells us, how buildings behave in an earthquake. We will do that by using what we call a damage function, and we want to understand how the building response to earthquake is estimated to develop those damage functions. Now, in terms of exposure, as I said, so we want to classify buildings by their main characteristics. Now, if I look at the building stock in a given region, it's very, again, it's enormously varied. And so we have, many, many different type of buildings with very different characteristics, very different properties in terms of materials, number of stories, and so on. So what we want to try to do is to identify some main structural characteristics that we can use for risk assessment. And you have already seen a lot of this earlier this morning. So what typically we do, we classify buildings according to what? To the materials that are used. For instance, is that a reinforced concrete or is a masonry structure? Then in terms of type of what we call in engineering terms resisting mechanisms, so is that made by walls? Is that made by frames? So if it's a reinforced concrete, for instance, is very likely to be what we call a moment resisting frames made by beams and columns. If I have masonry structures, particularly in the case of some heritage around the world, I may have more like kind of wall type of resisting system. And then it's also important that I know how tall is my structure, because usually I have that taller building may be more vulnerable than shorter buildings. And so I need to also give, and now of course again, each building will have a given number of stories, but what I want to do to make things a bit simpler, I simply say it's low rise if it's between 1 and 3 stories, it's mid rise if it's between 4 and 7, high rise if it's more than 8 stories. So for simplicity, I just try to have those three discrete categories. So what that means? So that means that what I do, I classify, so my building stock, which is huge and includes many, many buildings, can be classified according just to material, resisting mechanism, and the height of the building. And when I say height of the building, as I said in the previous slide, is simply one of these three categories. By doing that, so by doing all the possible combination of material, resisting mechanism, and AI, I usually go, so I reduce my thousand, thousand, thousand of buildings to 30, 40 classes that have similar materials, similar resisting mechanism, and similar height of the buildings. Now, not every building will fall exactly in one specific category, But when I'm looking at a portfolio, so when I'm looking at large number of buildings, this is enough to characterize the exposures and to make my vulnerability assessment. So after that, I can finally do some vulnerability assessment. So I can understand what is the level, for instance, of shaking from the probabilistic seismic hazard analysis or from the FEVR study that you have discussed this morning. Then I need to understand the building capacity so that if I bring those things together, I can understand what will be the building damage. Now, what I do from a mathematical and engineering perspective, I develop what is called a vulnerability function. What is a vulnerability function? So a vulnerability function is something like that, where you have on the horizontal axis, you have the intensity of the shaking, for instance, the peak ground acceleration from my hazard analysis. And then on the vertical axis, I have something called mean damage ratio. So the mean damage ratio is the ratio between how much would cost to repair my structure to the replacement value of the structure. So I'll give you an example here. It's not directly for earthquake, but it's for typhoon, so it's quite similar. And you can do the same type of analysis for any type of hazard of interest. So as I said, on the horizontal axis, you have the intensity. On the vertical axis, you have this repair on replacement value. So this, usually you have this S-shaped curve, because if your intensity is very low, you have very little damage. So how much I need to pay to repair my structure with respect to this value is usually very low, it's near to zero. Then if my hazard intensity, so I have what is called minor damage. Then if my hazard intensity increases, I will start having more and more damage. I have moderate damage, for instance. And so this value starts going, for instance, like 20, 30, 40%. So means that then to repair my structure, I need to pay 20, 30% of the value of that structure. If I have very extreme events, so I have, you know, Typhoon Yolanda or whole earthquake, I have very high intensities, but that means that I may have collapse of my asset. And so that means that this value will be 100%. So how much I need to pay to repair my structure is exactly how much I should pay to replace my structure. So repair and replacement will be equal to 101 of 100% in percentage terms. So means that to repair my structure, I need to rebuild it because it's completely gone. So this vulnerability curve usually goes between 0 to 1. So for very low shaking, very low wind speed, or very low flood water depth, I start at 0, and then increasing the intensity, I'll go to 100% if you are working in percentage. Now, of course, those vulnerability curves depends on what we said before. So depends on the material, depends on the lateral resisting system, if I have a frame, if I have a wall, depends on the number of stories, but also really depends on how old is my structure. Because, so that's similar type of function. For instance, in this case, I'm showing 3 levels of design. So I can have pre-code means that I didn't follow any building code. So that's something that was designed and built without following, was actually built, maybe not even designed. And that's something very often in the case that happens very often in the case of heritage structure. Low codes means there is some building code, but this building code is not very modern, is maybe an outdated building code. Special code means that there is a very modern building code that has a lot of requirements to make our building safer and resilient. So what that means? So that means that my vulnerability curve that I showed in the previous slides also depends on the level of building code that I have. So if I have a very special code for the same level, let's say I take 10 meters second square of acceleration due to an earthquake, I will have a damage here of about 35%. If my building is old for the same level of shaking of 10, I will have actually a damage of 70%. So I'm here, sorry, it's covered by these figures. If I have something low code, this level of damage is around 65%. So really it's important that we know the level of building code to make sure that we can also understand how building are. So if my building is very old, it's very vulnerable, it becomes less vulnerable if my building is more modern. So how we understand the level of building code by using, for instance, the age of construction. So if we know in which year that building has been designed and built, I can associate, and I'll show in a second how we did that, for instance, in Iloilo 4 by using the evolution of the Philippines building code. So now, of course, there is a lot of uncertainty in doing this, in a sense that you have this nice and easy to work with curve, but then there is also a lot of uncertainty. So for instance, you can have that you have two buildings, they are exactly the same. So on paper, they will have the same vulnerability curves, but then given the same typhoon here, for instance, one building was completely collapsed, and the other building is here with some minor damage. So what that means? That means that I have this sort of, you know, curve, but I also need to have some sort of probabilistic distribution of how much the damage will change. So for the same mean value of damage from that curve in the previous slide, I also have some uncertainties that I need to characterize. Now, without going too much in details, how we develop those damage functions, there are various ways. One way is to do it what I call empirically. What that means? That means that after an earthquake, after a flood, after typhoon, I go in the field and I start collecting data. So for instance, this is an example of a flood. So I went after a flood event there, I was collecting the level of damage, the level of water, and so by applying some statistics, I was developing the curve, vulnerability curve that I showed before. And that's one way to do that. Another way to do that is to develop those curves, to do some expert opinion type of analysis. So for instance, what I can do, I can call an expert and ask a lot of questions. Say, you know, what do you expect will be the damage if you have 1 meter of water due to a flood? Or what is the level of damage that you expect if you have an acceleration of X meters per second square, or G, G is the acceleration of gravity. So I ask experts to give their expert opinion, and so I develop those judgmental type of functions. Finally, what I can do as a structure engineer, I can do a computer model of my structure through, for instance, a software that does structural analysis. And what I can do, I can push my structure, simulating, for instance, the water in the case of flood, simulating the ground shaking in the case of an earthquake, or simulating the wind pressure if I'm looking at typhoon. So in the first case, very simple, it's possibly even the most realistic one, because I go in the field, I collect the actual data after an event, and then I build my vulnerability model as before. In this final case, I need to do complicated engineering analysis, while in the expert opinion case, I'm kind of in between. So I use an expert that possibly is familiar with some structure engineering concept, but also maybe has gone through some post-event type of data collection, so can help me in developing my expert opinion those type of function. I'm not spending much time in doing in detail through that. I'll share with you the slides after. But the idea is that, you know, the first one is usually very realistic, because you got the data in the field. The last one, but what is the problem of the first approach? So the first approach is true that it's very realistic, but also means that, you know, it's very expensive to go always in the field and collect data. So at some point, we'll have a number of points, a data sets that is never so huge. And so you need to make assumption if you want to apply those same data, for instance, to another geographic area. This final approach, because it's based on computer simulations, it's easy to replicate, and I can extend to many type of buildings, many type of analysis, but of course also requires a lot of very advanced skills. So usually it's good if I have individual structures and very specific structures for which I can do very advanced computer model of the structure, but otherwise it is a bit more challenging if I have, for instance, many buildings in a given area. So really there are, in terms of time and computational effort, and so I go from, you know, that increase when I do computer-based simulations, but on the other side, that also means that I this is more like building specific than this other one, where I can apply this across the region for buildings that have similar topologies. So long story short is that at the end of the day, we have all those, so we have many of those functions already. So there is within, in the US, something, the FEMA, which is the Federal Emergency Management Agencies. So they develop a tool which is called EZUS, where essentially you have a database, a collection of those vulnerability and also fragility functions. So fragility and vulnerability are slightly different in the sense that vulnerability gives you on the vertical axis the mean damage ratio, while fragility you get the probability of damage. But that's the same concept. So you have an intensity of your hazard on the horizontal axis, and then here you have what is the probability of damage. And for different level of damage, it can be slight, moderate, extensive, and complete. So it's similar to what I showed before. The only difference is that what I was showing before had on the vertical axis losses, so how much I need to pay to repair with respect to the replacement value of my structure, while here I have a probability of having damage. So really, when we started the Cherish project, the idea was, how we can use existing fragility relationships and models and vulnerability models, as the one that I showed before, for instance, from Mezus, to develop a simplified scoring system for risk prioritization for various assets. And this was really our task within the Cherish project. So I'll show you how we solved that. As I said before, we didn't have to reinvent things from scratch because we had this previous project called Scosso that already helped us in developing some of those ideas that then we further refined in the Cherish project. So the idea, first of all, was to have what we say is a multi-level approach, what multi-level approach means. So we went through, first level one is where we did the rapid visual survey, and you have learned a lot about this in the previous few in the past few hours with previous speakers. Then the idea was, let's do a more detailed level two where we go inside the buildings by using, like tools like 3D camera, drones, and so on, to understand a bit more what is going on within those buildings. But then let's even do, as a structural engineer, a level three where actually we try to get the actual drawings. Sometimes it's very difficult to actually get the drawings, but at least, let's use some other tools, for instance, rebar detectors and so on, to understand a bit more of what is going on in my building so that I can refine. So in terms of data collection, I go from a rapid survey to something very detailed. And similarly, from a vulnerability assessment, I go from a risk prioritization, and we'll discuss this in a bit, to something a bit more advanced where I do fragility and vulnerability as those that I've described before. So by doing a computer model of my structure, I can develop some sort of F. So the focus is really how we make sure that what we are doing in this level one is somehow informed by these more advanced approaches using the existing tools that we have. So as I say, the starting point was this Scosso project that we did together. It was led by Dr. Gigia della Salle University and Professor Reta and myself and Professor Dayal at UCL. So we did the same, pretty much the same thing that you have seen today. So I'm not spending time on this. I'm going very quickly through this. So we were doing the same exercise, but in this case, for school buildings. So we were not looking at heritage structures, but we were looking at school buildings. And the starting point was, let's review all the existing guidelines that exist across the world, around the world, so that I can use those as a starting point to develop my form and to do something more. So what we did then, we went from our UCL campus. So, oops. So here in London where we are, we went to our case studies in that first project. So in that first project, our case study was Cagayan de Oro. So we were not working yet in Iloilo. Iloilo was part of the Cherish. But in that first Scosso project, we went in Cagayan de Oro. And so we did the same exercise that you have seen so far in terms of rapid visual surveys for those school buildings. So we were able to fill these forms, and we were able to collect data, statistical data on those structures. Again, I'm not spending time because it's not the focus of this, but it's really the starting point. So, but really the idea then was, now we know for each of those hazards what matters in terms of characteristics of the buildings. And so what we wanted to do is to use some existing fragility function to calibrate a simplified scoring system. So what we did, and that's a bit tech savvy and a bit more complicated slide, but I'm trying to make it simpler. So the idea was, we have all those, so Ezus in the US, we say, gives us all those vulnerability and fragility curves for various type of, structure like concrete, shear walls, moment frame, masonry, and so on, for different type of, high rise, mid rise, low rise, but also for different type of codes. So if I have that, what I can do, I can enter in this curve with a given level of intensity, for instance, PGA. And what I can do, I can understand, you know, what is the relative value of probability of damage for each construction typologies. So what we developed a simplified index, not different to what we have seen so far, but that rather than be just based on expert opinion, was based on those fragility functions. So the idea was I enter with a given level of hazard, I take the relative damage probability of each of those combination of material, number of story, and code level, and so that I could assign a score, which I call is the baseline score, IBL, that really depends on this relative vulnerability from my fragility curve. So rather than just be based on expert opinion, I simply use my existing fragility models to develop this. And so, fine, but then of course, you know, I'm classifying my building only in terms of those, you know, material, number of story, and age. But then I also know there are many other variables, and you have discussed those in details in the past few hours, that also will affect my vulnerability. So what I need to do, I need to sum this baseline score that comes from Mezus to what I call a performance modifier. So PM stands for performance modifiers, which accounts for all these secondary parameters. And that's very similar to what you have seen earlier today with Professor Oreta and with Dr. Richard and so on. So really the idea is that I can give scores. So I can first of all give scores to each of those secondary modifiers, and then I can give a weight to each of those second modifiers, and those weight are usually based on expert opinion on consultation with, for instance, with engineers. So finally, I get this vulnerability index that I can use for my risk prioritization. So again, it's not very different to with respect to what you have seen earlier today. The only main difference is that we have this baseline index that actually depends on some vulnerability model, numerical vulnerability model that has been developed and that helps us in giving a more objective way to, you know, a relative vulnerability scoring for each of those categories of buildings that I have. Again, the good news, as I said before, so this project, these ASUS functions that we are using are from ASUS, that is a US-based tools. But the good news is that if we look at the evolution of the National Structural Code of the Philippines, from the very first one in 72 up to the most recent, hopefully I've not missed anything, in 2015, we can map to the Uniform Building Code in the US. So we can say the 72 Building Code of the Philippines was inspired to the 70 Building Code in the US, and so on. So we could have a mapping between those two. And so that means that I can associate, based on the construction age of my building, I can give one of those tags that I need for my fragility, like moderate code, low code, pre-code, no code, according to the Filipino building code at that age where the building has been built. Again, so we did this exercise for our assets in Cagayan de Oro. I'm not going in detail to this. And really, based on that, we could rank those structures and say, you know, which one are those that have a high vulnerability index, so that are more vulnerable, and for which I need to do something more detailed. I need to do that level 2 or even level 3 analysis that I showed in my previous slide. And so we actually did also some of this. And I'm going fast on this because I know the time is short. We were also trying to understand, you know, what are the, what we call the structural vulnerabilities. It's not just the building itself, but it's also, for instance, you know, if you put like furniture or cabinets right here and you want to evacuate because there is an earthquake, those cabinets actually can overturn, and so that actually can obstruct the exit of people. Or, you know, the beautiful flowers here, nice, but then again, if there is an earthquake, they can collapse and they can actually eat people that are evacuating the structure, and so on. So what we did, then we tried to, and again, sorry if I'm going fast, but I know time is short. So what we try to do, so what we learned in this COSO project, we try to replicate it now in the Cherish project for our heritage structure in Iloilo. So again, the same framework, but this time, again, using our Cherish form that Richard has greatly described before and has guided you on how to use it. And so we did the same exercise to the all the structure in Iloilo City that you have seen before. So we went, and so a team from UCL of researchers, together also with other partners from other universities in Italy, we had a field survey campaign in Iloilo. I think it was in 2019, so nearly 2 years ago. It was in July 2019, so nearly 2 years ago. So we were able to collect the data, as you have seen before with my colleagues, for those buildings, including use, for instance, you know, drones, like for instance, to survey the roof, because we didn't want to just look at ground shaking. We also want, were interested, for instance, on wind. For wind, the most important part is actually the roof. So, and so we also want to make sure that we could well model the roof and understand the roof of our structure so that we could develop the same score. And then also we were using, again, some digital technologies to help in filling, because sometimes it's very challenging to fill this form, as Richard has shown you in the field, and you don't always have access to all the information. So the idea was that, you know, through those digital technologies, we could try to supplement the data that we don't have in the form and try to make a more informed decision. So based on that, we were able to do a statistical analysis of the buildings in Iloilo according to the cherished form that you have seen before. But then, very importantly, with respect to the SCOSSO project, so the SCOSSO project was only looking at schools. When we look at heritage, as we have discussed before, also in the Q&A session in the forum before this presentation, the intangible value of heritage is actually very important. So what we did, we actually use a scale that has been developed by UNESCO that classify heritage structure in four categories, depending on their significance for a given community or for a given region. So you have a building that can be little significance, means that is just local significance, so it's not national significance, then can be of national interest, and so it's some significance, can be protected by national organization, so considerable significance, and then it's exceptional significance, usually if it's considered a World Heritage in the UNESCO list. So based on that, we could again give a score depending on this level of significance, and also we could give a weight to, so these are the weights and these are the scores. So if my building has, you know, exceptional significance, I give 100% score, and this I also weight it of 46% when I do my weighted average. So again, we apply this for all the buildings in Iloilo. So we were able to do something similar to the SCOSSO before. And again, I know the focus of this presentation was only on seismic, but we really did it actually also for wind by looking again at the roof, roof characteristics, roof materials, and so on. And then we also try to combine those doing kind of weighted average of those two indices to come with a multi-hazard indices. And then what we did on top of that, we also added that cultural value that I was showing in the previous slide. So that we finally had. So the idea was, again, I can now identify those red buildings that are those that red, and that's very important because I'm not doing any detailed structural analysis. Of course, I'm not saying there is an absolute vulnerability. I'm saying relatively to each other. So in my portfolio, with all the nearly 30 buildings that I have in Iloilo City that I've looked at in Iloilo, those in red are those that require some more attention. So I should do something a bit more detailed to understand if they are actually vulnerable or not. So again, that's very important. This is a relative vulnerability index, in a sense that makes sense if I compare all the buildings to each other, but only in absolute terms. So this may be highly vulnerable, but that if I do structural analysis may actually be safe and may be fine. But relative to the other, it's the one that has more vulnerabilities than the other, and so I may need some more attention and to do something. Now I'm done. So we did a paper together with all my colleagues here today. So this paper is freely available at this link. I can also put the link in the chat. You can download, where there are many more details. My presentation was short and I really want to give an overview. But really, if you go through this paper, you please discuss in detail all those things that I've been saying until now. So I think it's very useful. And of course, if you are interested, please get in touch. And, you know, even after today, if you have specific questions about the paper, the study,